Please rise with the pledge of allegiance.
Pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic which stands one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please remain standing for a moment of silence for the sick, handicapped, departed, military personnel of our community, and particularly Officer Basham from Canisburg Police Department, who tragically lost his life last week in the line of duty. Thank you. Roll call, please.
Mike Palmer.
Here.
Luke Bellagucci.
Here.
Joel Henderson.
Here.
Ron Asbell. Doug Blossom.
Here.
Bellagucci.
Here.
Bert Cherry.
Here.
Pat Rayner.
Here.
Thomas McDonough.
Here.
Jeff Slade.
Here.
Lori Collins.
Here.
Chad King. Bill Filio.
Here.
Dan Miller.
Here. I'd like to call Mary Weiss, clerk of the city, please.
I'm here tonight for a very, very brief request of sorts. First of all, I want to mention the program at the end of this month, the last Tuesday of this month. We had made 270 copies of this at the last one. So we will be making more. You will get a notice in the mail. We are honoring Curtis Cody and Sina. Why do people know about that? Secondly, we do have our 2017 calendar, and I love it, but I love the back of it. Yeah, they're $10, so don't worry about it. You can pay me, I'm paying. Baldwin Street, 1940s. Look at the business places. Fantastic. Whoever did all that work. But anyway, that's what I want to tell you, they're in and available. And then one other thing I want to mention is for the borough. And the borough idea that I have is that you keep pestering, nagging, pressuring PennDOT to do the exchange up at the top of Boyce Road, where Boyce Road meets Morganza Road. We need it.
Well, they're doing the southern connector, which would be just further down.
Yeah, but that area. But I'd like to see that done in my lifetime, since they promised me 8 years ago it would be done. Thank you.
Bob Fryer, please.
Thank you.
How you doing, Bob?
Yeah, not too good. I have a couple of questions. In terms of the proposals that have been put on the table for PennDOT to make the major improvements to Washington Pike and the alleged Seven Lane Bridge and so on, have you guys heard any, have you seen any drawings?
Actually, PennDOT just awarded the contract last week.
To do the construction?
No, to do the design.
To do what?
The design.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the design.
Design and utility coordination.
I think it was McCormick Taylor.
Yeah, they did the data collection too.
I'm not sure.
When you say they were awarded the job to do the design, what's the design? I mean,
they're design consultants. So they're reviewing what they have right now.
Even the data they have.
They're probably taking all the conceptual information and all the data and putting together the plans. When we met with Dan Sessa there earlier in the year, he said that they had money, and PennDOT had money in their 2016 budget to proceed with the design.
Yeah.
But they felt that they had enough information to assemble that, what they needed and get a team going. So. I mean, if they just awarded it to them, McCormick Taylor would probably just go over the information, and we'll probably have to have some kind of kickoff meeting with the district.
I just got the information last week, and then they know that they would be meeting with the task force. They would be meeting with all the communities, gathering information, going over what we have. So it's just in the beginning stages, but they have it delivered.
When is, Laurie, is there a period where Bridgeville like in writing, tells them we'd like to have the road made from the post office to the 7-lane bridge, 5 lanes wide near the bridge to put in a left turn stacking lane. About, I'd say it was within the last month or so, Dan Sessler called me because I asked him to do so. And I emphasized to him the importance of having that left turn stacking lane in front of the Bethany Church, but not taking anything of the church's property. So every time a car stops there, that wants to turn up church, here's it won't stop all the exiting of traffic out of Bridgeville. And I would talk for maybe just 15 minutes on the phone. Then I think the next meeting, you mentioned that he had, or someone from Pennet called you and said they were going to put the left turn lane
stacking. They were talking about the left turn stacking lane. And when we meet again, I think that's when we'll be gathering all of it. This will be final information now.
Is that when you'll be able to tell them?
Right. I mean, we've given them some conceptual information, engineer drawings, but they're still conceptual. And now this firm is coming in to finalize and work with us.
Yeah.
And then we'll move on to construction.
So. When I was going to say, I'm speaking for myself. I'm sure you guys get more information on it. But I hardly ever hear anything about what the heck goes on at the task force meetings. How long has it been since?
Since we last met at PennDOT, and the last thing that PennDOT said was they were going to do an RFP to get the consulting firm.
Things are still. Yeah, I just want to make sure that
we're moving along.
That we get what we want.
Right. We're all here to make sure that happens.
That's good. One other thing I want to mention to you. About a month ago, I was given a very interesting design that I think the Bridgeville Parking Authority paid for. They developed a 56-car parking lot right next to the First Commonwealth Bank in that vacant lot. I think the Kosky family and the Dreon family own that. And I didn't even know anything like that existed, but it was laid out like some of the designs I've seen, but it didn't even include probably an additional 12 of the spaces on the land that was part of that ARCO Realty building. You're talking about a 60 or 65 car parking lot. I was wondering, have you guys discussed moving ahead with that, with that parking lot?
We have. You're talking three different pieces of property. Three different owners.
Yeah, that's exactly.
Yeah, so it's right. As far as we getting those two people together, and I mean, you're.
The only person that has come to us is PD Capital, who owns the building that has access to, and they
wanted a variance on the grade, mm-hmm. and they wanted a variance on paving the lot. They wanted to purchase the property from Kosky and then pay it a year after you purchased it.
Well, they have a 20-year lease with
right
now. So they didn't want to pay it.
I'd like to suggest something to you, as I have before unofficially, I guess, but the number of businesses that moved in around the parking lot that you guys in the county built next to Burger's and like a little coffee shop and so on. It's like, I mean, there's a dozen new businesses that moved in there. That's what happens anytime you put in a major parking lot where there's a parking space efficiency. Is in Bridgeville. That piece of property that's owned by those three people, that's probably the last vacant piece of land in Bridgeville. And I think that the parking authority and the council's approval should be more aggressive in getting that property, okay? In other words, I know no one likes to force someone to sell their property to the municipality, but doing that would not only benefit the other 5,000 people in the community in lots of ways, it would create another circle of businesses around there of a much higher class than there are now, and it would, and the people that own those buildings, like the ARCO building owner and the Dreons and the, whoever owns the old Farm Use building, that their rents would probably double. I'm not arguing with you, Bob. I know, I'm not arguing with you. I'd like to see you guys be more aggressive.
Well, we can, there's definitely things that, you know, that you would, everybody would love to see in the town. It obviously doesn't happen overnight. But yeah, I would definitely take under advisement as far as being aggressive as we can. But, you know, we are talking about people who we all know that might not be willing to do that.
I know that, but I was going to say, you know what I think part of it is that I don't think some of the people, or maybe all of the people that own the buildings, realize what it would look like, and they would end up with storefronts on the backs of the side.
They actually do. I mean, those businesses have been, aside from a public solution, right. I happen to know that the owners of those buildings have been in communication with each other. That parking lot actually would serve, whether it was publicly or privately owned, those same businesses, the Commonwealth building, the ARCO building, and the other buildings that are around them. So they actually have had some degree of communication with each other. They could actually provide their private solution to their own private parking lot.
In other words, you're saying, whether they did it themselves to build 60 cars or whether the borough did it, it would be about the same.
No, I mean, that aside from just the single lot, those folks that own those various lots have been in communication about wanting to combine, share,
how far that's gone. That's a good step in the right direction, but what I was hoping for, the advantage of the borough moving in and guiding the line of reasoning to get them to sell the borough the property is, you'd own that property, someday put a parking garage there. And the people that own those properties, they
Parking garage, building on top.
Right, well, that could be. But what, the thing I'm a little concerned about is, there was no talk about someone buying that lot and putting a building on it and compounding the parking problem even more in Bridgeville, was there?
No.
Well, that's true. Yeah.
But if you build a building, you have to be able to show parking for it.
Well, not in the central business district. I think.
You have to show that you can produce parking that can serve that building. Whether you can go out and get it off an authority or here or there or rent it anywhere, you have to be able to show that you can meet the parking needs of the building one way or the other.
I was going to say, correct me if I'm wrong, I thought in the central business district, you have an ordinance that says if someone buys a building in the central business district, the parking authority has to provide them the parking.
Right. Right. They have to work with the parking authority to get that parking.
I don't know. Am I mistaken, Lord?
Well, or a private.
We have an ordinance well. That states that if you're within 600 feet of a metered parking lot, you're exempted from providing the parking.
For your building, yeah.
For your building. So if they're 600 feet from a metered lot, right now the ordinance states that they're exempt.
Yeah.
So.
Well, it's something. Keep in mind that's an important consideration.
The private solution is a good one. And as the solicitor mentioned, those property owners have been in touch with each other. What we lack is a willingness amongst those property owners to try and move forward. Unfortunately, if the private landowner doesn't see value, it's very difficult to move a project forward. I'm hopeful that when they do see value, we'll be more receptive. I'd point out that what was the company that PD Capital came, and the answer to the variance question was nope, don't want it. So I would point out
they didn't meet the requirements.
There was not really a hardship, and I understood the zoning board's decision. It had merit. The zoning board did what it was supposed to do. I bring this up because it's another example of where our zoning law was an impediment to moving forward. Small impediment, but an impediment nonetheless. Was it really all that vital that the lot not have one more degree of slope?
Safety issue.
We can come up with a dozen reasons why we like our rules exactly the way they are. Just remember that there are consequences to what you put in place.
You know, excuse me, I don't mean to keep going on with this, but I have some stuff I'd like to submit to you guys. There are features on that lot that would vary greatly between the owners trying to do it and the borough trying to do it. For example, the level of the parking lot behind the Harmuth building is 4 feet higher than the rest of the property, and some interesting two tiers could be made there, which would, in addition to that, the Bank Street Station Street is the second most important consumer motor stride in the Bridgeville Central Business District. If the lot is done designed correctly, when cars would come down Station Street, just as they got past the bank on the left, that street could be extended up through the backs of those buildings. It would provide another ride into the largest central business, or our biggest parking lot, which means cars would be going up to the traffic light, turning light left, and having to go into the parking lot that way. So, but anyway, I'll provide some stuff for you. I'd really like to see you more aggressive about that stuff.
Thanks,
okay, thank you.
You came in late after we had the sign sheet.
Sorry, yeah.
That's all right. Do you want to?
Better late than never, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ready to sign that for you?
If you want to.
That's sure.
And you can get a rate set.
Robinson, I'm the general manager of Rail Yard Grill and Tap Room. We're a new business in the neighborhood. And we simply, that's Ash in the back there. He's part of the ownership group as well. And we just wanted to say hello, basically introduce ourselves. We are a new business. Obviously, we're going through getting ourselves ready to do our grand opening on the 26th of November. Some of you have visited us already. Some of you haven't. We invite you to come down. Basically, what I wanted to say is, we don't want to just be another business in that community. We want to give back to the community. We've actually, and I've got some flyers here, we're doing a food drive and we're going to be collecting food to donate to the Bridgeville Food Bank. We're also collecting some pet, untampered with pet items as well to donate to the local Humane Society. This is just a step in a direction we want to take as far as giving back in our community. Yes, we're a business trying to make money in the community. We're trying to be educators in the food business. I don't want to be just another restaurant that has a great selection of beer and a great selection of food. We're trying to educate people when it comes to food. We're using local providers, local purveyors, as close as we can to home. We're actually using Lobella Beans salad dressing on our menu because I know Debbie very well. And we want to basically reach out and say, hey, it's not just about us coming in and making a bunch of money and forgetting about where we are. It's about the history of Bridgeville. We're in a building that carries a lot of history. We understand that, we know that. Aside from the urinal where Frank Sinatra took a leak, there's a certificate in my office where Frank Sinatra took a leak. Historical landmark, and that's great. But beside that, we want to honor the history of the building. I've actually reached out to the Historical Society. I met a couple that came into the restaurant that their grandfather helped build the original building, and they're trying to locate some photos, and we're going to put some of those up in the building just to show, hey, we care about Bridgeville, we care about the history of the building that we're in, we care about coming in and making a difference for a positive way in the community. I lived in Bridgeville for a few years back. I was born and raised in Dormont at the KO High School. Don't hold that against me. But I know Mr. and Mrs. Gallarducci, they've known me since I was a child. If you want a funny story or two, ask them, they can tell you one about me. But they know my parents very well. And the way I was raised is, you be a solution to problems, not cause them. We're a restaurant, there's things that go on when you serve alcohol. I want everybody in this room to know we are very much on top of those things. You're not going to see a lot of issues coming out of our bar. I've already had to let go a few employees that have come in that have been doing things that haven't been up to our standards as far as representing us well. So we're going to police ourselves with that. We've already touched base with some of the officers in Bridgeville Police and have let them know where we stand with those sort of things. So I want you all to realize that I take this very seriously. This is my life's work. And not only is it, yes, we're a business to make money, but this is our reputation, and I can speak for Ash when I say that we care about our community. We named the place Rail Yard because in the 1880s, the railroad connected the country, it connected the country to the world. And in the same respect, we want to connect our customers to the flavors of the world, but at the same time, a rail yard was a meeting place where things happened, where the comings and goings of commerce happened. And we want to be the same way with the guests that come into our restaurant, the people that come in. We know we're going to pull people from all over, but we understand where we are, and we want to make sure Bridgeville is well represented. And so with that in mind, I have a couple flyers with this. I'm going to leave them. I can. We're looking for ways that we can reach out to the community. So if there's things that you want to contact us about to make us aware of so that we can begin to give back. I know there's a lot of events in Bridgeville that take place that we'd like to be a part of, especially coming up this time of the year. There's a lot of needy families out there. We would love to help in any way that we can. I've been so busy with trying to get the place off the ground that I'm like this right now, just trying to see above water. But I don't want to lose sight of where we are and the people that we serve. And people are important to me. My employees are important to me. And Bridgeville is important to me and to Ash. And we just want to let you guys know that, hey, we're here to help. And we'd love to do anything we can just to be a positive influence in the neighborhood. And that's really it. So
when's your grand opening?
Our grand opening is November 26th. It's the Saturday following Thanksgiving. We're hoping that there'll be a lot of family members in town that are from out of town and college students that are home, so we can touch base with a broader...
Any special hour?
All day long.
All day.
We've got things for the kids starting at 11 a.m. We've got a magician, balloon artist, makeup, the face painting going on. We're going to do a ribbon cutting ceremony that we would like. I'm going to reach out to the borough. We'd like you to be a part of that as well. And then we're going to be doing our dinner specials and working with some of our partners, and we're going to have some live music starting about 9 o'clock as well in the evening. So we just want to introduce ourselves the right way. We want to let you know that we are here to basically help grow Bridgeville. It's not about just ourselves. So with that in mind, thank you very much for your time.
We welcome you, and we wish you all the luck. I know we want to see you succeed as well. Because anytime you have a strong business, it helps our community. So,
absolutely.
Good luck.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Appreciate your time.
All right. Move on to the regular meeting. Minutes. Motion of the Borough Council regarding the minutes of October 10, 2016, regular meeting as submitted.
So moved.
Bruce, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Calendar year 2017 budget workshop advertisement. Motion of the Borough Council confirming the advertisement of the budget workshop meeting on to be held on Tuesday, November 22nd, 2016 at 6 p.m. I'll move. Joe Rucci.
So.
And Bruce Delrucci. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Calendar year 2017 proposed budget advertisement. A motion to Borough Council confirming the advertisement of the calendar year 2017 proposed budget to be available for public inspection on Monday, November 28, 2016. This advertisement will meet and exceed the 10-day public review requirement per the Borough Code.
So moved.
For Cherry and Joe Rucci. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Calendar year 2017 CCTV project advertisement. Motion of the Borough Council authorizing Manager Collins to advertise the request for bids for the 2017 CCTV project as prepared by Engineer Seitz.
So moved.
Bruce?
Second.
And Joe Mrs. Westmoreland. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Calendar year 2017 sanitary sewer repair project advertising. Motion of the Borough Council authorizing Manager Collins to advertise the request for bids for 2017 sewer repair project as prepared by the staff. A second?
A second.
Pat, have a comment?
Yes. Our sanitary sewers continue to be a problem in this community and in this region. We are under consent decree from the Federal Environmental Protection Agency. And what it basically comes down to is that when it rains, water, rainwater, groundwater, infiltrates our sewer lines. In dry weather, we have a flow of... Joe, can you help me out with this? What the flow is in dry weather coming down versus wet weather? It's orders of magnitude higher in wet weather.
Oh, that's what you mean. Yeah, there is orders of magnitude. I mean, there's probably 3 to 4 times more, maybe more in certain parts of the system in wet weather. But there is always some kind of flow occurring in the sanitary sewer system.
Right. So this isn't a matter of how much you run the water in your shower or how many times you flush your toilet. The fact is, the groundwater is seeping into the sewer line, and when it rains, 3 to 4 times the amount of sewage has to be treated. The pipes can't carry it, so raw sewage overflows out of the pipes. It backs up into the basements of residents on Baldwin Street. I know there is a committee to look at that. I would really hope that we might be able to get some solutions there. But more importantly, it shoots manholes off the top of the pipe, and you end up with raw sewage in McLaughlin Run, you end up with raw sewage in Chartreuse Creek. Long ago we figured out it wasn't a good idea to put sewage into the creek. Okay. We used to have a cesspool behind the fire department. Because we haven't solved our inflow and infiltration problem, the best solution we could come up with is to take a pipe and take the raw sewage that used to overflow behind the fire department, we now have it go through a pipe and dump directly into the back channel of Chartreuse Creek. This is not good. This is a problem that has been plaguing our region for years. What? Bert, you were dealing with it the first time you were on council, correct?
Yep.
Okay.
And it is region.
It's not plaguing Bridgeville. This is not unique at all.
Yeah, this is...
It is being worked on by being worked on by groups of municipalities, and I am bringing it up because we are again looking at point repairs and making dirty movies. But so that everyone understands. What I mean by dirty movies is you go through you go through the sewer line and
take pictures
and see if there's something wrong with the sewer line. We've done this. I know that we're going through another every 5 years you want to do them again, right?
Well, this is what the operation and maintenance manual.
Right.
Okay. And it states here, priority sewer lines are to be televised based on an as-needed basis with consideration given to complete televising every 3 to 5 years. So this documentation right here, this form, as it was prepared and it was reviewed and approved by the Allegheny County Health Department for us to be in compliance with the consent decree, it is the manual that we have to follow to do CCTV. The entire system has to be televised every between 5 and 10 years. Last year, we didn't do any point repairs on any of the system as a whole in the borough because we took the money that was budgeted and focused on all the repairs that we did on Washington Avenue in conjunction with PennDOT and Pennsylvania American Water. So this year, 2017, we're returning to our plan to continue to look at this level 4 and 5 defects have those repairs made, that's what's required with this manual here, and continue to be in compliance with what's required of the consent decree.
And as a note, there's a quarterly report that has to be submitted to the Allegheny County Health Department certifying what percentage of work that we have completed. So we simply cannot say, well, we're just not going to do pump repairs this year because we'd rather not, because we're simply not going to do CCTV because we just don't think that we can do it this year. We have no choice.
We can videotape a sewer this year. We can look at it 5 years down into the future, and we can see something that's totally different in a run of pipe, especially with the terracotta pipe that we have. You know, I'd love to see us at some point in time be able to line every sewer in Bridgeville Borough so that we won't have to have breakage that occurs from roots and other intrusions on the terracotta pipe. But you know, we can't be taking all the infrastructure on with one big bite. You know, somebody I know used to make the comment, how do you eat an elephant? A little small bites each at a time. Okay, so this work, the CCTV and the sanitary repair work, is operation and maintenance that we need to do every year to stay in compliance and have a viable system. Okay? And not have those 3 o'clock Friday afternoon calls from someone that says they're facing that issue.
Let me stop you there, because that's exactly what we have, are those 3 o'clock in the afternoon calls. Because as much as the EPA is forcing us to do certain things, they don't specifically tell us exactly which bites we ought to take.
Well,
we have to fix this problem. They have, there is a consent decree.
Well, we have a map that outlines.
I'm familiar with the map, and I'm familiar with the consent decree.
And can I just add something? The 3 o'clock afternoon infiltrations that we get on Baldwin Street are homes right now that do not have backflow preventers.
Mm-hmm.
Homes that have backflow preventers are not getting anything in their basements. I got a notification that I have 3 houses. We sent out notifications, gathering information to see who had backflow preventers, who did not, you know, when they put them in, how they were working, that type of thing. And the houses that were affected don't count. So the choice is now we have a committee to work on that, but it's going to be, so what do you do for the people that already put them in?
Yeah.
So that's going to be something that the committee would need to work on. But that's who's getting it. The other people are not.
Correct, which is why you formed a committee to look at this issue, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's why you did that. And I'm pointing this out, I'm slowing down the motion seconded advertisement forward to put on the table the issues that we have. Not that most of us don't know them intimately. We do. That's why you appointed a committee to look at Baldwin Street. My hope is that it will come back soon with an answer to the manager's question of how you're going to deal with those 3 houses or how many ever don't have backflow preventers, and how you're going to deal with the residents who are responsible and put them in so that they are not penalized by being responsible. And that leads me to the main point. There is double Joe, the amount of lateral pipe than there is of main pipe. Is that
typically on a street, if you have twice as many lateral feet of lateral pipe on the street in comparison to the main line pipe on the street?
Makes sense.
Okay, because of everything coming from the side. So the focus has been working on the main line trunk line sewers. Okay, now we have to turn to the laterals and start working on getting that.
Now you're talking about personal.
Yes.
Individual homeowner.
That's why I'm bringing it up at a public meeting. Because I'm talking to the individual homeowners who are sitting in the audience that are out there, as well as us as individual homeowners, because, you know, we've got properties that have to be dealt with. The lateral that goes from, the sewer line that goes from your house to the main line.
Mr. Chairman, I'm sorry.
Has inflow and infiltration. So you can not flush your toilet and not take a shower, and you are still allowing water to get in the sewer system and overcharging its capacity. And so I am asking that we as a governmental body be proactive, and we look to implementing something that allows our residents to be responsible and to fix their lateral at a time and place when it is convenient for the resident, rather than waiting until it is imposed upon us by an outside force. Okay? Simply put, as a country, we've decided that you don't put your raw sewage into your waterways. Because we, as a region, have not complied with that, the federal EPA has sued us and we have a consent decree. As part of that, they're pushing through mandates. I'm asking council to work on getting ahead of those mandates so that our residents can fix the problems in their lateral, in their sewer lines, before they're required to do so, before we are forced to require them to do so. And that kind of program could be very easily implemented. Okay? A carrot approach would be a very good idea, and it might be an interesting demonstration project. Joe, I don't know, do we have, part of this last consent decree was for us to do a demonstration project?
We're working on putting together a demonstration project right now using we did some flow isolation here earlier this mm-hmm. year that looked at the flow of sewage at night. Mm-hmm. We have assistance from the police department, public works to do that work. So we're looking at those sub-watersheds in the borough as a location for possibly doing some lining of those sewers and to see, that's one, doing lining of some of the sewers is one of the flow isolation items. Another thing is green infrastructure. So we're looking at the options. We haven't nailed down a final project at this time.
I think this might be an interesting concept to throw on the table, to use a carrot and stick approach of some sort with our sewage connect or tap fee. Not tap fee, what do you call the monthly?
The user fee. Those user fees are governed and their use is governed. If you're talking about paying people to fix private portions of their system, that raises a private.
No, I'm not. That's not all what I'm talking about. Okay. I'm not talking about that at all. I'm talking about looking at those as an incentive that if you have eliminated the inflow and infiltration into your lateral, that perhaps you not have to pay a monthly fee. Then you'll have to figure out how to get it done. But that's what I think we ought to, as a governmental organization, look at. But we faced this many, many years ago, and we were one of the first communities to look at the dye testing. We were one of the first communities to be out there and do a demonstration project. You remember the one on, what was it, Passavento, where they did the in situ form? Mm-hmm. Okay? We are, as a community, affected more than other communities by the overflows. They happen right here. They happen to our residents. We need to take the lead on this process. I would ask you, as council, let's get that committee to get an answer, not only on the backflows, but also to maybe take a look at the lateral.
Okay. Pat, okay. If you know something about overflows that are occurring in the borough, I'll let me know so we can go and address them.
Okay, we know about Baldwin Street.
Those are the ones that we know about.
Well, we've had the guys pull the mains. We have Roto-Rooter heading down there to take a look to see if we have a buildup of debris. As far as anywhere else in the borough, I've had no issues and no problems.
But those are the places.
Right.
Behind the fire department, down on Baldwin Street, and if you go up McLaughlin Run, it's actually in Upper St. Clair where the manholes usually pop off. I mean, those are the ones. No, at the I'm not telling you about sewage overflows, you know, in the highlands of Bridgeville.
No, but you know, as far as any homes go, anyone on McLaughlin, nothing. We've had nothing.
No. Lori, you're very familiar with this. You know the problem. I'm not throwing anything on the table here that much of council doesn't already know. You know it. The region knows it. I'm trying to say we need to be moving forward on some on proactively solving it. And if all we're going to do is make more dirty movies, fine. But I think there's a lot more that we could do, and our residents would benefit from it.
So, motion in a second.
Yep.
Yeah.
All those in favor?
Please move forward.
All right.
Motion carries. All those opposed?
Motion carries.
Oh, one other item.
You don't want the garbage bill.
Exactly. We should get rid of the garbage.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Bill list. Motion to the Borough Council regarding the November 2016 bill list. Is it Joe Grucci? Is that for our chair? All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Payrolls, motion for our council approve the payrolls of November 18, 25, December 2, and 9, 2016. All, Bruce and.
I'll second.
Who was that? And Bill Henderson. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Monthly reports. Motion to accept and pay commissions due to October 2016 real estate tax collector report. Joe?
Sir.
Rucci and Bruce Garucci. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion to accept the September 2016 financial report.
So moved.
Joe Rucci?
Sir.
And Bruce Garucci. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion to accept the October 2016 police report.
So moved.
Bill Henderson?
Second.
And Joe Colosimo. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion to accept October 2016 zoning report.
So moved.
Bill Henderson?
Second.
Oh, Joe Colosimo.
It was a tie.
It was a tie. All those in favor? All those opposed? Motion carries. Committee reports, registration, no reports. Finance, Joe.
As Lori reported, we do have a motion for the budget workshop meeting. It's going to be held November 22nd at 6 o'clock. I want to thank Lori for walking me through my first year of working with the budget, so it was very informative. She probably went home and went straight to bed after my two straight hours of questions, but it was very informative and really wide open discussion, so thank you. Other than that, that's all I have for you.
Thank you. Parks and Rec, Joe Colosimo.
Time of year, again, the water has been shut off at the park, so there's no restroom facilities down there. Generally, over the winter, Churchill's Park's closed on kind of the hill road going down to the park. It's not worth our public work, people trying to keep the road open. But if people like to take walks, McLaughlin Park, Cook School Park, and Triangle Park, they're open all year long, open access to them. So I'd like to enjoy the parks in the winter, go right ahead. Swings are still there, nice day, but just stay out of Churchill's Park. Public safety. So that's all I have.
All right, thanks. Public Works, Bruce?
What I have is we have a Public Works employee retiring as of Thursday of this week, correct?
His last day is going to be November 17th, but his retirement day is April 4th.
Right. But he will be no longer working after Thursday. And I just want to thank him for his years of service publicly. He's been very active in taking care of the borough. So I thank Bill Phillips for his time served. The other thing I have a list of stuff they've done, but the brush grinder program and the leaf pickup will continue to run until the first week of December, all through the month of November, and it follows the street sweeping schedule, correct?
Okay. That's a great service, by the way.
Yeah, and the brush grinder, the guys are telling me that everybody's using it, they can't keep up. There are rumors, so, but, you know, it's really a good service to the residents.
That's all I have, Mr. President.
Thank you very much. Public safety, Bill?
Mike, we got a couple of things in committee. The chief's been on vacation for a couple of weeks and be back later this month, so we'll come on into committee, or into the next meeting. Have a couple of recommendations.
Mr. Mayor?
Couple of items. I understand there's a flood control meeting on Wednesday.
Wednesday night, yes.
I'd like to point out that, and I don't want to preempt that meeting, but I just want to ask the question, Laurie. Are we looking at a situation where the flood control authority just does not seem to be maintaining the flood control project?
No, Pat, that's not the case.
That's not the case at all.
Okay, so we're going to hear about that at the meeting.
Right.
They continually do work. We meet as an executive board, and that's not the case at all.
The focus right now, Pat, is to get a contract out and do the clearing of the area through Carnegie. That's the next step. And then I'm in the process of going through all of the historical data of the flood control authority. It goes back to 1970.
Right.
And documenting when things were done. And then we're going to come up with a master maintenance plan that, you know, at certain timelines, certain dates, and certain years, this will be done on the flood control authority. So that's what we're doing.
I look forward to seeing that.
But I will not, it will not be complete for Wednesday night's meeting. It's a work in progress.
Okay. I'm being concerned most about our community, the area next to Bethany Church, and the back channel. Curiosity as to when that might be addressed.
That has yet to be determined.
There unfortunately has been some fraudulent activity reported by a number of Bridgeville residents and a number of residents in the area due to what's called credit card skimming. This is when you go to a gas station and you insert your credit card. Thieves put something on the device to record your credit card number, and then they proceed to drain your bank account. If you've been the victim of such a situation and you know where your card was compromised, a suggestion is to go to that police department and report the fraudulent activity. If you are unsure of where your card was compromised, the Bridgeville police are more than happy to take the report. They're working on trying to solve this. Unfortunately, it is.
Bad to add. Yes. Call their bank.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, call your bank. Like, before you even call anybody else to stop it. Yes, thank you. Because you want to stop the bleeding. But then oftentimes you need to make a report where the police department is here for you. It was an honor this weekend. It was a dedication at the War Memorial. That Jack Allarducci, as part of his Eagle Scout project, did the silhouette that is now in front of the War Memorial. So it was a very nice event, and we were also able to honor three individuals that were killed in action during World War II, two of them in World War II, and one of them in Korea. So it was a very nice event. I would remind everyone that Light of Night, or Winter Blast, is December 2nd at Triangle Park. And our flags will continue to be flown at half staff in honor of Cannonsburg Officer Basham until he's interred on Wednesday. That is all.
Thank you. I'm assuming Chief's not here, so you can report you want to be at.
No, I don't.
No problem. Just check this. Take one out, so.
No.
Solicitor, we need. I have to hear this. We need.
Engineer Sykes.
Thank you, Mr. President. Give you an update here, the CB 43 community development application for the Bridgeland Historical Society with handicap access. We completed the full application for the replacement of the existing handrail and ramp up to the Historical Society building. Gavin County Department of Economic Development will provide a decision early in 2017 with the availability fund. We've already covered the CCTV point repair contracts. 2015 pavement maintenance program contract B Bowerville Road. People's Gas completed the replacement of the main gas line. Performed trench restoration. We've discussed with T.A. Rawlinson and the manager about letting the road as is until spring and then complete the paving. This will give the trench the opportunity to settle if it does during the winter. The night temperatures have not been appropriate for night work at this time. There may be some minor repair work in public works. We have to cap some bottles on the road until spring. The Walker Run Park Phase 2 project, we've got the agreements and proceed with the design. We're working on the new parking lot, restroom upgrades, and pavilion improvements. And I'd like to get that, we've got to get that to the DCNR before the end of the year or no later than January, and then get their blessing to put it out for bid. We're anticipating a winter bidding for the project, but we won't have work done by Memorial Day. Update on the Washington and James development. We had a meeting with the developer and their architect on September 22nd. I wanted to put that date here as a benchmark so we know how long it's been. We reviewed the zoning ordinance requirements with them so that they can prepare their submission accordingly. To date, we have not received any submission or anything on that property. And then the Chartier Street, Washington Avenue, and Chartier's Creek Bridge intersection. The manager has been working on the necessary documentation to the Allegheny County Department of Economic Development for the grant, which is the amount of $300,000. And once they get the documentation, it's been submitted and approved, the design can begin. So they're asking for our first form.
We requested that they take the fence down, and they sent a notation back that they would prefer to keep it up due to liability reasons. So, we really, I don't know if we can force them to take it down.
What's this under?
Grass.
Let's look at the grass. Yeah, we can talk about it. My biggest concern is we've asked them to fill it in until 3 months. Then we're asking them for the last 3 months. Take the fence down. That's about that. We're going to run into issues when they start building it,
right?
Where they need to go buy something, and then there's an issue there.
Gotcha.
Do you have a state plain number of their punch list on the
list? Not at all.
Bill, Julia, Chief?
You have my report for last month.
Library, I saw Becky here.
Hi.
There she is.
Becky Wisdom, President of the Bridgeville Public Library Board of Trustees. We have a special occasion evening to talk about, by special invite, information that I have shared with the Borough Council. I am not going to go over every detail because I think you guys can read it and Lori can look at it as well. There are some pie charts, there are some graphs. One of the things, though, that is most significant about this report, and it has taken some time, because we're in an evolution. That library opened in 2011. We've gone through some changes. 3 years ago, we developed a partnership with the South Fayette Township Public Library. This report demonstrates the amount of savings or budget reduction because of that partnership. It has been a very positive experience. We each take turns attending each other's board meetings. We will have a meeting next month with both boards together with the Allegheny County Library Association and Marilyn Jenkins. We have very excellent staff. a great library director and a very good library manager at the Bridgeville Public Library. And so we felt it was important for you all to better understand how, what we've done, where we are, and that we're still moving forward to do, to make sure that we can cover the expenses for this library, enhance the attendance by the community and surrounding communities. And it has been really nice what has even happened this year. Unfortunately, at South Bend Township Library, they had a sewer that backed up that they didn't know was carpeted over. So when their library was closed, they came to our library and they were able to continue the programming and have a healthier environment until that was resolved. And it has been, and they've been able to return to their library. But please stop by. If ever you have, if you have more questions, we have our board meeting tomorrow night at 7 o'clock at the Bridgeville Public Library. We have members of our board that are from Collier, South Fayette, and Bridgeville. And we have to think about how the world is changing, and we have to think about what's important for the people. And a library in a community is invaluable to the value of that community, as is a good police department, fire department, ambulance service, and an efficient and effective borough council. So I'll let you all read the rest of this report just so you can better understand where we are, and I thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. This is really good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Borough manager, Lori.
I provided
the
written reports,
and anyone has any questions. I want to tag on to Lori's report. Me and Lori went to a conference last month on the convention center. It was the P4 conference. It was sponsored by the mayor of Pittsburgh, the office of the mayor, and the Heinz Endowments. And P4 stands for People, Planet, Place, and Performance. And it's about urban growth development that's innovative, inclusive, and sustainable. It's a really neat program. It was 2 days. It was speakers and workshops from all over the country, all over the world, actually. And it's not just about economic development, which is easy to say, oh, we're going to develop this area and put a Starbucks in here and all that kind of stuff. It was about how everything in your community is connected, kind of like what Lori just said, but I mean, Becky just said about the library and how it's all part of the community. It's about putting inclusive neighborhoods, walkable communities, stormwater, like what Pat was talking about. That's part of how do you incorporate like rain gardens and stuff in a development so you don't have the water going and infiltrating in your source. So you put that part of your development. Equitable development. So you don't just say, hey, we're going to put a really expensive restaurant in this town and people who live in your town can't shop, they can't even use it because it's out of their price range. So you put stuff that mirrors your image, mirrors your people. So it was a very informative conference. I got a lot out of it. I'd like to, especially if our planning commission is here, I'd like to share some stuff that we went over there. And there's a lot of online data there. So I just want to let you know what we did. So that's about it. And old business. New business?
Mr. Chairman, I can't.
Ah, there you go.
It's okay. No, I did raise my hand when Pat was talking about the sewer. I said it so many times while I was in council, for God's sake. He's repeating old stories. We do the work, and we've done the work with the meaning of our financial. May I ask, Lori, what's our sewage balance right now? If you, please, just give me a figure. 200?
Our balance is approximately $322,000, but we have a
$180,000 off of San Suzuki. $400,000.
So,
if we use those $400,000 tomorrow, we start using it. We don't do nothing. We need. hundreds.
Second, back to his, how do you know?
As you know.
See something?
As you know well, that I always say, your sewage bill, and that's on record, is going to be at least 4 or 5 times more, maybe 10 times more than your 3 utilities.
Right.
It will be. Already now it is, but 2 utilities.
Oh, it's.
And that's it. And I'm not in, excuse me, I'm not in a budget. I'm not an electrician. If you don't raise the sewage this year, probably you have already in mind, you have no choice. You need an infiltration. For many, many years I'm involved with this. The infiltration, I say one time, and I asked the engineer, if we would line all the sewage bridges, every single one, first of all, we can afford it. We're talking about a lot of money.
Right.
Second of all, infiltration, you always going to have. It's almost impossible to take the infiltration. We've got too much now. When I first got in council 30 years ago, I made a volunteer to everybody in Bridgeville correct their rainwater. Bridgeville is very cooperative. Everyone worked, and we offered the free advice from an engineer firm. Some have a harder trouble. It's the driveway, they're different. We give a free advice on how to do it. And many times I say over there, you should push voluntarily work for the lateral. Start them now, because it's coming. Actually, in the next couple of months, your next administration, whatever it is, you should actually implement that. There's no question about it. It got to be done. But give us some time to do voluntarily.
It's going to...
You know, everything that goes up. I mean, Bridgeville, where the hell are they going to get all this money?
Right.
Slow down.
It's a very expensive project to do it all right now.
Yeah.
But it isn't going away.
That's
and
right.
We're basically,
it will not go away.
Whenever you're paying for water to be treated, that shouldn't be treated. So if you can reduce, and we have to reduce as a community, as a country, as a world, but he's making
the
point.
He's
not saying anything new. We know it's coming. It's not an easy solution.
You need money.
Yeah,
$400,000. You know how long it takes the engineer to use $400,000?
Like, he could do it like that.
And he's going to do this much.
Right.
And we have this much. We need big money here. Damn it. Act. Use your common sense. Make sure the brain talks before your mouth. We've been saying that for years. You reinvent a wheel, for God's sake. That's on record.
Well, it's been on record for years.
Oh, okay, we don't have enough money to do. Why don't you give a couple $1 million and we do something?
Well, we watch this. Anybody have a motion to adjourn?
I'm sure.
But yeah, this on a good note.
On behalf of the Borough Council, I would like to congratulate the 2016 Boys Treacherous Valley Soccer Team.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
yes, there you are.
Okay, now I make a
round. All right, all those in favor?